to CCBC TV's Arts Showcase, a series featuring performances from the campuses of the Community College of Baltimore County. I'm Monica Otal, Professor of Music and Concert Manager at CCBC. Today's Arts Showcase features the Borowsky Trio, a trio of siblings with remarkable talent, pianist Elizabeth Borowsky-LeBlanc, violinist Emmanuel Borowsky, and cellist Francis Borowsky, offer a program of traditional piano trio repertoire as well as their own dazzling original compositions. In 2004, the trio received the Erick Friedman Prize for Outstanding Young Musicians, which led to their Carnegie Hall debut.
We are siblings. I wanted to start off with that. We grew up together, practicing and performing and traveling around the world. We've been to about 35 countries for performances, some of them at major venues like Carnegie Hall and others, the streets of Jakarta, Indonesia, traveling on a bus that turned into a stage and set up in the middle of the city. So we're so happy to be here at CCBC. We're starting off the program with a work that we wrote together back in 2008 when we were artists in residence at the Dillsburg Castle in Germany. And our entire task there was to live for 3 months and to practice and to immerse ourselves in our music making. And right before we left, there was to be a big concert. And we gave an interview to the newspaper, and our father was there with us, and they interviewed him. And we saw the newspaper article come out the next day, and it says, "Come one, come all, there's gonna be a great performance, and the Borowskis are going to be premiering their trio, Postcards from Dillsburg." At which point we did a double take because we had never composed a work together before. Thank you, Dad. And so there's nothing like a little bit of pressure to cultivate creativity. And so that's what we did. We sat there, we improvised, we thought about what are the memories that we want to take from this place and share with our family and friends when we come back home. So there are 5 movements, and we'll be telling you about them and hope that this will bring Dillsburg right here to CCBC.
I've been designated to tell you a little bit about each movement before we play them. So the first movement is setting the scene and is titled Morning in Dillsburg. The sun shines, the birds sing, and the river Neckar winds its way around the mountain.
Thank you.
The place where we stayed in Delsberg was actually in a castle, and this castle was over 800 years old. And if you actually read online about the castle, it was a very successful defense castle, so had been through a lot of battles. And so this next movement, titled Ready for Battle, is our chance to capture that feeling of battle. I'll admit that I was a little bit inspired also by, you know, Final Fantasy battle music. So you might hear some of that and also imagine it in a castle. So the third movement gives us a break from the energy, chance to fall asleep, but hopefully not as long as the legendary sleeping chamber, which this movement is named after. So legend has it, there's a haunted room in the castle where if you fall asleep, you'll sleep for 50 years. So this is about that.
Thank you.
I'm curious whether any of you caught the musical reference in this third movement. Has to do with sleeping. Anyone? Brahms Lullaby? Yeah. So it's, I guess, something which has been found again and again in composers throughout history. They like to quote other composers, especially famous works of other composers. So the fourth movement is a classic tragic love story, and the story is actually about as old as the town itself as well. I think the story is from the 12th or 13th century, and tells the story of the princess Rose, who is betrothed to the evil prince from across the river, the town across the river. But meanwhile, he goes off to battle, and they don't hear from him for a year. She falls in love with someone else who she actually loves. And on the day of the wedding, bad guy comes back, challenges the groom to a duel, kills him. And of course, Rose goes up to the castle and jumps to her death. So this is Rose of Dillsburg. Very uplifting, like many medieval stories, yes. And there's also a couple quotes in here as well, musical quotes.
Thank you.
The last movement is a lot more upbeat. When we were visiting there, it was actually the 800th anniversary of the formal establishment of Dillsburg. So, as you can imagine, there were parades and celebrations, and the last composition, or the last movement, is a march celebrating 800 years of Dillsburg.
I'd like to tell you a little bit about the history of this work. When Dick Smith was 15 years old, he was working four jobs in Washington, D.C. This was during the Great Depression. One of those jobs was at Constitution Hall, where he was a coat check. And he got to listen to a lot of great musicians come through that hall, so it was his favorite out of the four jobs. One day, Sergei Rachmaninoff came in and did a performance, and the audience, of course, went crazy and asked him for an encore. And he played something, and they asked him for another encore, and he played something else. But it was the third encore, which Dick Smith heard him perform, that was a moment that changed the rest of Dick Smith's life. Rachmaninoff ended up performing the prelude in C sharp minor, one of his best known works. And Dick Smith said that that piece started to haunt him. He loved it so much, he wanted to be able to create a masterpiece of sorts. The problem was that he never learned piano, didn't have a piano. It just became an idea. So what happened next? He enlisted in the Air Force and traveled around the world, was serving for the United States during the Second World War. And he would pick out tunes at the pianos at the bases and just kind of try to teach himself something. And then he returned home and he said he only dated women who had pianos, and he would show up early and go, "Don't mind me, I'm just going to practice on your piano while you get ready." And this carried through for several decades. And I met him when he was 95 years old.
at Oakcrest Village, not too far away in Parkville. And he came up to me and said, you know, I have this dream. I've been trying to write a piece my entire life. Would you help me? How do you say no to that? So we worked together. He had the melodies, things that came to him, and he asked me to turn it into a masterpiece. So of course, we blended his inspiration of Rachmaninoff with my love of Chopin and Liszt, and it became his life and impromptu. It was premiered at Oakcrest Village. It was covered by local television, and then the Baltimore Symphony Orchestra conductor Marin Alsop wrote in. And then this was picked up by The Story with Dick Gordon for NPR. And if you want to hear more about it, it is in their archives online. You can hear the live interview. So I hope you enjoy. This is Life and Impromptu.
Thank you. composers, perhaps most notably Schumann, have used or have changed the names of their friends into music. They've turned the letters of the names into musical notes. And that's what we did for this trio, Hardy. In the first movement, it's just solo cello, and there are five notes. But you might think, okay, H-A-R-D-Y, I don't understand, what notes are those? Well, we worked a bit at this and came up with H is B. A is A. R is D flat or C sharp. D is D. And Y is E, as in Hardy. And so the first movement uses just those five notes. And the following two, which we are playing, are based, centered around the next two letters, A and R.
Thank you.
The last three pieces on the program are not written by us. However, you may not have heard, you probably haven't heard this next one, probably not the next, and probably not the violin piece. The next piece that I'm going to perform is a tone poem by a composer out in California named Maria Newman. I met her a few months ago. And she was inspired by a fairy tale to write this piece. And that fairy tale was written in the 1900s by English author Mary De Morgan. It tells the story of Othmar, a young boy in a village who had the most beautiful voice and loved to show it off. However, one day, an evil dwarf, this is a fairy tale, came through to the village, heard Othmar sing and thought, aha, I need to have that voice for myself. But how? Well, they went on a walk together and Othmar returned to the village completely voiceless. He couldn't speak, he couldn't sing, he couldn't make a single sound. When he cried, it was, they were silent tears. So what happened? The dwarf was gone, and Othmar had no voice. Fortunately, Othmar had a friend named Huulda, who thought from the very beginning that this dwarf was a very shady character. And so she took it upon herself to go find that dwarf and get that voice back, which she did. And this piece, Othmar, by Maria Newman, tells that story.
Thank you.
The next work on the program is a Spanish Latin American infused piece written by a Czech-born composer who was known as an Irish violinist with the skills of the famous Italian violinist Paganini. Confused yet? Okay, so this work, Spanish Rhapsody, combines a lot of traditional, or what we would recognize as Spanish, as well as Latin American dance rhythms and idioms, namely the paso doble, the rumba, and the habanera. So habanera, which we probably know best from Carmen fantasy, the Carmen opera, bum ba dum bum bum, that rhythm, is originally from Havana, even though it was made famous by a Spanish composer. And the paso doble, maybe in video game culture, we recognize it most from Super Smash Brothers. So that rhythm, bum ba la pa 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 bum, is actually a very famous Spanish rhythm, which is also used for bullfights. So we'll hear that, and then of course we'll hear the rumba, which is based off of an African rhythm called tresillo, which is da, 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 da. Sort of these three notes over top of a two. So you have a bunch of rhythms, and then you combine it with a lot of really flashy violin stuff, which requires skills, so we're gonna see how this works. Rhythm plus skills. Spanish Rhapsody. Thank you.
The last two trios on the program are both by Astor Piazzolla. And I wanted to share a couple of stories about him that I found captivating.
Last two works in the program are by Astor Piazzolla, and I wanted to share a couple of things about him that I found interesting to share with you. Astor was the outsider. He was smallish. He had to prove himself to himself and the world. One leg was shorter than the other, so he took tap dance lessons and played baseball to show that he wasn't different. He fought, he connived, he survived, and he taught himself to play the bandoneon. Well, it seems like, okay, end of story. And in fact, the beginning of the story sounds pretty smooth as well. But this is what Astor wrote about his beginnings with tango. My first bandoneon was a gift from my father when I was 8 years old. He brought it covered in a box, and I got very happy because I thought it was the roller skates I had asked for so many times. It was a letdown because instead of a pair of skates, I found an artifact that I had never before seen in my life. My dad sat down, set it on my legs, and told me, Astor, this is the instrument of tango. I wish for you to learn it. And I was angry. Tango was the music he listened to almost every night after coming home from work. I didn't like it. So Piazzolla actually started off by playing music by Bach, Gershwin, and Stravinsky on the bandoneon, and he aimed to become a classical composer, though along the way made some extra cash by playing in tango establishments. And at some point he went off to France and was studying with Nadia Boulanger and played his works for her, and she was unfortunately unimpressed. And she said, tell me about your life, tell me about your music, about your roots. And he finally sheepishly admitted that he also plays and writes tango music, and she asked him to play it for her, and she said, that's your music, go home, do that. So later on in life, he said, I still can't believe that some pseudo-critics continue to accuse me of having murdered tango. They have it backward. They should look at me as the savior of tango. I performed plastic surgery on it. Cellist Yo-Yo Ma said this, and I will leave you with this quote. Music is always one way people can speak when they aren't allowed to express themselves otherwise. And Piazzolla's tangos have the great strength of true voice. His music is endlessly passionate and full of yearning. So we're playing two works by Piazzolla to close off the program. We've been so excited to share our music with you as well. We have sheet music for it. If you're interested, just go to borowskytrio.com and send us a line, and we look forward to being in touch. Thank you.
If you would like to attend a Music Forum concert, please note that each Friday during the fall and spring semesters, the Music Department of CCBC presents Music Forum concerts at 1220 in the Recital Hall of the Arts and Humanities Hall on the Essex campus. These concerts are an integral part of our students' education, and all of the concerts are free and open to the public. For more information on Music Forum, please call 443-840-1521 or visit our website at ccbcmd.edu/performingarts. I'm Monica Otal. Thank you for watching CCBC TV's Arts Showcase.